Hi, LA Progressive friends and family. Dick and I are delighted to once again sit down and have a chat with Bill Blum. As usual, the topic of this conversation is the Supreme Court and the role, significant role that the Supreme Court plays in our lives. Bill Blum is a former judge and death penalty defense attorney. He's the author of three legal thrillers published by Penguin Putnam. He's a contributing writer for the California Lawyer magazine, for Truth Dig, and we're so happy to say for the LA Progressive. Welcome, Bill.
Thanks. Always great to be with you.
So this article, the article this week is the American way of death. Typically, as you point out, when we think about the out of control gun population in this country, we point our finger at the National Rifle Association. But you point out in this article, really a major villain is several key decisions by the Supreme Court. Do you want to tell us what the importance of the Heller, the District of Columbia and Heller decision?
Sure. So let me give you a little bit of background because you mentioned California Lawyer Magazine, which is no longer publishing. But the last cover story that I wrote for them in 2015 featured the attorney in California who's the main contract lawyer, independent lawyer for the NRA, the National Rifle Association. And during the course of preparing that article, I researched the Heller case and consulted with some real experts on the history of the case, including Professor Adam Winkler from UCLA, who wrote a great book on the case called Gunfight. And Heller was not the brainchild of the NRA. What really came about through the Second Amendment Foundation, which wanted to push the envelope and get a case before the Supreme Court to get it to overturn the then existing general understanding that the Second Amendment was not designed to address civilian private ownership of guns, but was designed from the beginning to protect ownership of guns in connection with service in the colonial and now state militias. And the NRA later joined that case when the Supreme Court accepted it for oral argument. So Heller dealt with the prohibition on handguns in the District of Columbia, federal enclave. And to the disappointment of court watchers and people who understood what the Second Amendment was really all about, the Supreme Court ruled 5-4 that lo and behold, the Second Amendment did protect a right to individual civilian gun ownership. And that really set the ball in motion for two subsequent decisions, McDonald versus Chicago, which extended Heller to state and local governments, and then the Bruin case from 2022, which created this history and tradition case to test gun rights challenges and making it much, much easier for courts to reject gun control legislation. So when I say that the Supreme Court is one of the villains in this situation, it undoubtedly is, because with the elevation of gun rights to a constitutional right, rather than a right that would exist state by state, locality to locality, it's now easier to overturn gun control legislation than it has ever been in the United States before. And there's a direct correlation between the proliferation of guns in the United States and mass shootings and gun violence, both homicides and suicides in the United States, pre-Heller and post-Heller. The Supreme Court is not the only factor involved in this escalation and this epidemic. But when you think of the Supreme Court as an institution that's designed to protect democracy and civilization, it's inescapable, in my view, to avoid pointing the finger of blame at them as well. And if you go back and you read the Heller decision, and Heller is not as extreme as Bruin, the later 2022 decision. Heller was written by Scalia, Bruin by Thomas. The Heller decision, the majority opinion by Scalia, ends with him saying, well, we know that there's an epidemic of gun violence, particularly handgun violence. and that our decision will take certain policy decisions off the table. But that's what we do. We're the Supreme Court, and we interpret the law, and we don't pay attention to consequences. And when you compare Heller, for example, to Dobbs with abortion, the Supreme Court's happy to say you have no constitutional right to abortion, so we're going to leave it up to the states to regulate abortion. But it's exactly the flip when it comes to gun rights. Now you have a constitutional right all across the country, and state governments can have their gun control regulations and legislation, but those are going to be subject to the constitutional floor of the Second Amendment. So you have exactly the opposite situation. Once again, you have the court employing the tools of originalism, but to reach predetermined outcomes. So it's just another tool for reaching the result that you want with a reactionary Supreme Court, undermining the rights of the people in the instance of gun control to be safe from gun violence, and in the instance of abortion, for women to have control over their reproductive choices. So a sad day, another sad day for the United States. I wrote the article because of two reasons. First, we have another spate of school shootings, most recently in Georgia. And second, even Kamala Harris and her campaigning is saying that she's a supporter of the Second Amendment. You know, it's one thing to say that you support gun rights based on state regulations. It's another thing to say that you're a supporter of the Second Amendment. But she almost has to, because now, courtesy of the Supreme Court, the Second Amendment's been reinterpreted, and virtually everybody has come to believe this phony baloney history that the founders created the Second Amendment because they wanted to create an individual right to own and bear arms. That is simply not true. The founders weren't concerned with that individual right when they crafted the Second Amendment. It was all about preserving the militias and preventing or mitigating the rise of a standing army in the United States, which the founders feared would be a vehicle for tyranny. That's the history. That's the true history. And it's been abandoned and covered up and distorted by the Supreme Court. And I've consulted many experts on the Second Amendment on this question. The Supreme Court simply got it wrong. But now, because it is the Supreme Court's holding, and because guns are so popular, even liberal Democratic Party politicians have to say they support the Second Amendment. There's no room for nuance here. And the problem is that when you elevate a right to a constitutional right, it's harder to regulate it. So that's the issue. That's the problem. I'm afraid that unless and until we expand the Supreme Court, we're never going to reverse the Supreme Court, the Second Amendment jurisprudence that got out of hand on the wrong track back in 2008 with the Heller case.
So I remember the Heller case. I'm one of these people who went to law school late in life, and I was actually in law school when the Heller case was decided. And we spent quite a bit of time talking about that, talking about the Second Amendment, and then also talking about a well-regulated militia. The Second Amendment is my least favorite. It's my least favorite for a couple of reasons. Obviously, the gun issue is a big issue, but I hate the way it's written. I'm going to read it. A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. To me, it seems grammatically or possibly the structure of the sentence of the it's just a single sentence is very awkward and difficult to really understand the intention of the founders. But one thing I've learned from many scholars is that this well-regulated militia that they're speaking of, they left out a word, and that is slave militia. because in order to get the first 10 amendments to the Constitution, to get the Bill of Rights incorporated into the Constitution, they needed that in order to get all 13 colonies to agree. And one of the things that was really important was slavery, even though the word slave is never mentioned in the Constitution, and I believe intentionally left out of this sentence, they meant a well-regulated slave militia. You want to talk
Right.
at all about that?
Well, sure. The militias, particularly in the slaveholding states, were instruments of repression and control, and of course, excluded from the requirement that the yeomanry, the citizens of the states, own guns were black people. Black slaves, they couldn't own guns. So, yes, the militia were reactionary entities, but like so many other things in the founding era, there are nuanced aspects to these entities. And the militia were these repressive organizations, but at the same time, they stood in contrast to the standing army, which the many of the founders looked at as just as repressive, if not more so. So it's kind of a mixed bag. But and the Second Amendment is so ambiguous on its face that you really have to look at the ratification debates to see what was going on. This was all designed to preserve the militia, and you're right. So the purpose of it was to preserve slavery. And of course, slavery does appear in the Constitution in the three-fifths clause and the fugitive slave provision in the original Constitution that if you're a slave and you escape, that the owners can get the slave back from the state to which the slave fled. But the Second Amendment was designed with slavery in mind, and it was not designed with unfettered individual gun ownership. So when we flash forward to the modern to today, the main distortion that the Supreme Court promoted and embraced in 2008 was that the amendment was designed, that its purpose was to protect individual gun ownership, disconnected entirely from membership and service in the militia. And that's a terrible misunderstanding. Some of the experts that I consulted with way back when called it law office history. So you have these justices of the United States Supreme Court playing historian, and they aren't trained historians. And as you well know, that as historians delve deeper into the past and they discover more documentation, they reveal more about the past. But once you have a Supreme Court decision which freezes the understanding and says that because later in the 19th century, more and more states, individual states in their individual constitutions were adopting individual gun ownership provisions, that that somehow reflected back on the Second Amendment itself when it didn't. It was really an exercise in the 10th Amendment, which says that the rights set forth in the Constitution are not exclusive and that states can provide for additional rights. So that's the history behind this. And that's one of the reasons why it's so hard to have comprehensive gun control measures in the United States today.
So you point out that Antonin Scalia said his job as a Supreme Court justice was simply to interpret the law and not be concerned with the consequences. But do these Supreme Court justices and all the lower court justices, do they live in bubbles? I mean, as your article points out, since they passed these decisions, gun ownership skyrocketed from an absurd 300 million guns in the country to 470, 45,000 deaths where it used to be 30,000, and I believe about half of those deaths are suicide, skyrocketing mass murders of to 633. And with Dobbs, we see women are dying. The consequences are of Dobbs that already women are dying. You say that the solution will be if there's a larger court or a different court, but with 470 million guns in the country, what kind of law do you think we could enforce that would change this crisis?
Well, it may be too late to have the kind of impact that we should, but I think you could have a prohibition on semi-automatic weapons.
No kidding.
And And on new ones, I think it could have an impact. I think you need much tougher background checks to prevent teenagers and the mentally ill and felons from getting guns. We have many laws preventing felons from getting guns, but I think that that's going to come up again before the Supreme Court. That was one of the items that Scalia said was presumptively presumptively valid controls on felons possessing guns. I'm not sure that the current court would agree with that, or they would try to distinguish that aside in the Heller decision and say that it really wasn't the holding in Heller. It was what we call dicta, just an observation that's not binding law. So I think that there are things that can be done. We have to try. At the same time, I'm not saying that the Supreme Court and the law are the only drivers of gun violence in the United States. We have a violent culture.
That's right.
And as long as we have a violent culture, we pit people against one another in a struggle for survival, we're going to have violence in the United States. As long as we have a society divided into an obscenely rich, tiny crust of people that run the show, and the rest of us who live month to month, hoping that we keep our jobs, we're going to have a lot of violence in society, and the guns only make the violence easier. So it's a complicated question, but insofar as guns are control are concerned, we have to do what we can. And I think that given the state of the law now, the Supreme Court has to be shamed into upholding certain gun regulations. And they did that last term in the Rahimi case, where the court upheld a federal law that prohibits individuals who are under domestic violence protective orders from possessing guns. And the court really said, oh, you know, if we look at the history of gun regulations in the United States, we really do find some support in the founding era for preventing certain classes of people from possessing guns. Well, yeah, that's true, but a strict original analysis probably would have resulted in in upholding in overturning the federal law as Clarence Thomas in dissent wanted to. John Roberts in the majority decision said, well, you know, we can't have these originalist understandings written in amber. So he backed away without rejecting the Bruin analysis.
What
So
does
I
he
think that
mean? What does
pressure
he
can be brought.
mean by written in amber?
It means fixed in stone,
Oh.
means rigid. So if the founders, and remember, women had no voice at the founding. They couldn't vote. So when the originalists talk about the original public meaning of the Second Amendment, they're not talking about women's understanding of the Second Amendment. They're talking about the understanding of propertied white males. And their understanding. So originalism is really, as I've written many, many times, and as others have written more eloquently than I, is hypocritical, nonsensical, but it's a tool that's used to shield judges and to have the public believe that they're making their rulings objectively and not based on their personal political preferences, when exactly the opposite is what's going on.
So one of the things that I like to try to end with is Dick and I always talk about he's the one that is the glass half full guy, and I'm the glass half empty. But when we talk about the Second Amendment and the proliferation of gun ownership in the United States, it can feel overwhelming and hopeless, especially when you consider there's over 400 million guns. But then I remember that there was a time when you'd go, when I was a kid, you could go to the doctor and sit down in the doctor's office and have a talk, and the doctor would be sitting there smoking a cigarette. Or it's just, and the way that we handled the smoking of cigarettes and the drastic change in the United States, that change happened as the result of a concerted, intentional campaign to change the culture. And so, in addition to decisions that are made by the Supreme Court and what we're taught in schools, I think that we do have the power to invoke a cultural shift, especially as more and more people are impacted by this terrible gun violence that we experience in the United States.
I think that's absolutely true. And surveys show that the vast majority of Americans do favor stricter gun control legislation, like improved background checks, stopping the gun show loophole, where you can just go to a gun show and pick up a gun without a background check. So I think there is hope for this kind of cultural shift and for that wing of the population, which says, okay, the Second Amendment means more or less what Scalia said it meant, but let's have more regulation. Because Scalia, in his opinion, did say that the Second Amendment is unlimited, but then Clarence Thomas went off in a crazy direction, as he often does, and basically undermined even the limitations that Scalia recognized. So I think there is reason to believe that we can make that paradigm shift culturally within the current legal framework, and that this court can be shamed into upholding sensible gun regulation. The court is very, very concerned about its declining reputation and what I and others call its crisis of legitimacy. It's very concerned about that. And we have to press that whenever we can. And we have to press politicians to implement and argue for sensible gun control regulation. And that includes the Democratic politicians too. They can be pushed more easily, but they do have to be pushed.
That's right.
So I'd like to pick up on Sharon's point about cigarette smoking as a longtime former smoker. It was a government program, and it was pushed by the American Medical Association, and it had a top-down component. But ultimately, what made it succeed was the populist absorbed that this made sense.
Yeah.
I think the same would be true. The Supreme Court can, and all the courts can do what they can do, but until everyday people think that it's stupid for people to have 470 million guns and automatic weapons and all that kind of stuff. And I am the glass half full guy. I think chipping it away, one thing, background checks, no automatic weapons, more registration, piece by piece, we may get to a more a reasonable position, but I think it'll, like cigarette smoking, it'll take decades.
Well, I'll tell you one thing that caused a huge shift in the acceptability, the social acceptability of just smoking in restaurants and smoking in schools was the campaign that the American Cancer Society did, where they really showed the ugliness of it. I can never forget, there was a woman who had to have, I guess it was a tracheotomy, and she was even taking the cigarette and putting it to her throat. And
Remember that commercial.
yeah, you never forget that. And I think that in America, we hide what these bump stock and these semi-automatic weapons, what they do to the human body. If we could have seen those pictures from Sandy Hook, I don't really want to see those pictures, but I think that that would have made a difference. We need to see what these guns do.
Yes, and next term, the court so far is has agreed to hear a case involving ghost guns. These are guns that you make in your own home.
Oh, brother.
Good grief.
Okay.
Well, this is
Well,
delightful, Bill. We love your articles. We love your work. We love talking to you every week or so. Thank you, sir.
thank you, Bill.
Thanks so much.
All righty, so long.
So long, guys.
Thank you for sticking around. If you like the LA Progressive content and the discussions we have here, please consider clicking the subscribe button below and also give us a thumbs up. That helps to grow our audience by feeding the algorithm, which helps to get this content in front of more eyes. Thanks for stopping by. We really appreciate your support.